So prior to colonization in the Americas, there were certain rivalries between the French, the Dutch, the British, and the Spanish. And once colonization began, these rivalries ended up spilling over into the New World. Along the way, they drew in many different American Indian groups into these conflicts. So in this episode, allow me to enlighten you on all of the amazing wars and conflicts that went on during the colonial times between various different European groups. Now, before we get started, I do want to mention something to you. We are going very brief through most of these battles. We are not going to be going super in-depth. If you're wanting super in-depth on these battles, first off, they're not really that important, so I don't know if you can get a lot of in-depth stuff on them. But we're not going to be covering, like, major battles and stuff like that. We're going to be kind of talking about basic points of the war that APUSH students might need to know for their AP test. So that's just something I want to keep in mind. So you war veterans out there, you're not going to get a lot of, like, certain battles and, like, specific military strategies and stuff like that. So now that I've said that, without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into today's episode.
College. I probably shouldn't brag, but dang, I'm amazed and astonished. The scholars say I got the same virtuosity your brains as my pops. The ladies say my brain's not where the resemblance stops. I'm only 19, but my mind is older. Gotta be my own man, like my father, but bolder. I shoulder his legacy with pride. I used to hear him say that someday I would blow us
all away. Ladies, this is APUSHLESS, the AP United States History Show, where I attempt to teach the amazing APUSH content provided by College Board and attempt to translate it into a way that is so engaging that not only APUSH students want to listen in on the show. Especially because there is no homework, no textbook readings, no primary source documents, and no writing entire essays in 30 minutes. I am your fellow student and host, Trevor Bushnell. And let's get into the episode. So the first conflict we're going to be taking a look at are the Beaver Wars, which lasted from 1640 to 1701. Now, European nations formed alliances and traded firearms with the natives, and this intensified the impact of armed conflicts. This also shows how destabilizing influence of trade and firearms were on the relations between American and Indian tribes. Now, the Dutch and French established trading posts to get furs from the natives. France had the St. Lawrence River in the early 1600s with the Algonquian tribes, and the Dutch had about Albany, New York in 1614 with alliance and trade with the Iroquois Confederacy. Now, the Iroquois wanted to expand their trade network, but the problem was that the Huron people that we mentioned in the last episode happened to be in the way. So in about 1645, the tensions between the Iroquois and Huron became open warfare. Britain ends up overtaking the Dutch in 1664, and they ally with the Iroquois Confederacy until the war's end in 1701. So some major effects of the war that you should probably know about are that the Iroquois expanded their territory and influence. The Hurons suffered basically ultimate disaster. You can learn about what that ultimate disaster was back in the last episode. And the war also contributed to a realignment of native alliances and reorganization of societies. Next up, we're going to go ahead and talk about the French and Indian Wars. This is really what's going to make up the rest of this entire episode. So the French and Indian Wars actually make up four separate major wars. They are King William's War, Queen Anne's War, King George's War, and the French Indian War, because historians are very so great at naming things. The French and Indian War was also the most decisive, as it eliminated the French military and government presence in North America. Now, all these wars follow very similar patterns. The first three grew out of conflicts in Europe between Great Britain and France, and the fourth originated in North America and then turned into a conflict between two very different empires. These wars also involved and intensified rivalries between native groups. Various Native American tribes ended up allying with the British and or the French. They also maintained autonomy with these alliances as they were able to control territory, and these changes with France's withdrawal from North America. To clarify on that last point, these alliances change when France withdraws from North America. These wars also tended to increase bonds between colonists and the British government. During the war, the colonists felt they needed British military power, but post-1763, colonists re-evaluated the relationship with the British crown. Now, I should say that we're only going to be focusing on three of these four major wars, as the French and Indian War is actually the beginning of Period 3, so we're not going to get to the French and Indian War until we get over to Period 3. Which, as I'm flipping through here, Period 3 is actually beginning pretty soon. I think we're going to be getting it not the next episode, but the episode after. Yeah, the episode after we're getting Period 3. So in Episode 15, we got the French and Indian War coming up, for those of you war veterans. We'll take a break and then come back to French and Indian War. But anyway, let's begin by talking about King William's War, which lasted from 1688 to 1697. Now, the cause of this war was conflicts over British and French borders, as well as concerns of competing native confederations. Now, the Iroquois Confederacy had come to dominate the fur trade as a result of the Beaver Wars, and this was challenged by French colonists and their Indian allies. In 1688, there were various skirmishes in New York and Canada between Indian groups and European allies. During this war, there was also a lot of violence over boundaries specifically between New England and New France. English settlements in Maine happened to be encroaching on the French settlement of Acadia. Acadia, I don't know how to say it, but it contained things like Nova Scotia and Maine and New Brunswick. The natives engaged in this war formed what was known as the Wabanaki Confederacy in an attempt to halt further English expansion after King Philip's War. After this war, the Iroquois Confederacy, which was completely decimated, negotiated the Grand Settlement of 1701, I believe. I can't read my notes and see if that's a 1 or a 7, with France and the other natives. And the Iroquois remained neutral over the North American conflicts for about the next 50 years. Next up, we have Queen Anne's War from 1702 to 1713. Now, this war was located on the border of Canada and the American South. British forces had controlled Newfoundland and the Hudson Bay, which was a problem because the boundary between Maine and Acadia was actually left unsolved. Which is kind of ironic because that's why people fought in King William's War in the first place. Now the Wabanaki Confederacy, as expected, joined the French in an attempt to stop British encroachment. The Wabanaki Confederacy staged a raid on Deerfield, Maine. Psych, I actually didn't mean Maine, I meant Massachusetts, Deerfield, Massachusetts. But anyway, they destroyed the town, they killed 56, and they took 112 captive. One of the captives, Reverend John Williams, wrote a best-selling account for his capture and return to Massachusetts. His daughter, unfortunately, chose to stay in Quebec and marry one of the natives there. As such, this decision caused soul-searching among the family and other various Puritans. Down south, European powers, along with the native allies, fought for territory. France had pushed down the Mississippi River to reinforce French claims by Robert de la Salle in 1607, and Britain began to push west from the Carolinas. The Chickasaw Indians emerged as active participants in procuring slaves for British traders and allied with the British. The Choctaw Indians ended up allying with the French in an attempt to get back. Now, there were also emerging tensions between Great Britain and Spain over the boundary between Florida and Carolina. As such, France and Spain formed an alliance to challenge British presence in the South. What's very important that you should know about this war is that Queen Anne's War didn't settle boundary issues, but it did weaken the Spanish presence in Florida, and devastation led to the natives that were already in that area. The Apalache Indians and the Timucua Indians were destroyed in a massacre by Britain in 1704. The Chickasaw Indians also suffered, but they could still hold against the Choctaw and Illini tribes. These attacks forced the Chickasaw to become more dependent on Great Britain. Now, the fighting continued into the 1730s, but it wouldn't stop until the defeat of the defeat in the French and Indian War in 1763. The final war we're going to talk about in this episode is King George's War, which lasted from 1744 to 1748. The war was fought in the area of New York, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and Nova Scotia, and included a successful siege by Massachusetts soldiers on the newly built French fortress in Louisburg in Nova Scotia. To counter this, French and Indian forces ended up destroying Saratoga in New York. It also should be noted that this war also did not settle ongoing territorial disputes, much like Queen Anne's War. In the peace treaty following the war, Britain agreed to return the fort at Louisburg to the French in exchange for France returning the city of Madras in India to the British. Now, this decision angered a lot of the northern colonies, which had lost a large number of men to the cold and disease while occupying that fort during the harsh winter after the siege. And that's all in the European Wars today.
Mr. Secretary.
Mr. Burr.
Sir. And did you hear the news about good old General Mercer?
No.
You know Claremont Street?
Yeah.
They renamed it after him. The Mercer legacy is secure.
Sure.
And all he had to do was die.
Yeah, that's a lot less work.
We ought to give it a try. Now, how you gonna get your debt plan through?
I guess I'm gonna finally have to listen to you.
Really?
Talk less. Smile more. Do whatever it takes to get my plan on the Congress floor.
No matter. APUSH is supported by Google Sites and YouTube. As always, I'm your host, Trevor Bushnell. The content supporters are Barron's and McGraw-Hill and their respective APU United States History study guides. The music is by the Hamilton original Broadway cast soundtrack, because, I mean, what else would you plan an APUSH podcast? If you'd like to find the show notes for this show, as well as other resources, as well as updates on the show on the channel, those can be found over at my website, over at sites.google.com/site/APUSHLESS. If you'd like to find the episodes of APUSHLESS, you can find them in the public OneDrive folder for download. That link will be on my website as well. You can also find them at YouTube for streaming. And if you're on YouTube, make sure you leave a nice comment for me and subscribe and turn on notifications so you know when my podcasts are coming up. If you'd like to contact us with questions or leave us an amazing review, go ahead and contact us at feedback.apushless@gmail.com. Or leave us a comment in the YouTube comments. We are a group of nerds based out of the Pacific Northwest town, Ferndale, Washington. Thanks for listening. We'll see you guys in the next episode.
Sacrificed in every game of chess. We just assume that it happens, but no one else is in the room where it happens. Meanwhile, Madison is grappling with the fact that not every issue can